Hello and welcome to Bangladesh Today. I am Smita Prakash. In this episode, we focus on Bangladesh's largest Islamic political party, the Jamaat-e-Islami, whose leaders have been implicated and convicted of war crimes, mass murder, rapes, and forcible conversions of the minority Hindu community. After a high court recently banned the Jamaat from electoral politics, it has stepped up its attacks on innocent civilians and damaging public and private property. Let's have a look at the party's past and what lies for it in the future. Post-1947, Bangladesh was a part of Pakistan and was known as East Pakistan. Soon after the liberation of Bangladesh in 1971, following a nine-month-long violent struggle against Pakistan, the father of the nation, Sheikh Mujibur Rahman, banned communal politics in the country and declared secularism and socialism to be state principles. These steps were taken to stop the rise of Islamist forces, especially the Bangladesh Jamaat-e-Islami. This party was not in favor of breaking away from Muslim-majority Pakistan. The cadres even collaborated and helped the Pakistan army in killing freedom fighters and intellectuals in 1971. The president of the Kochi Kachar Mela, the National Children Organization, and chair professor of the Institute of Bank Management of Bangladesh, Ibrahim Khalid, said that the Jamaat-e-Islami and its student wing, the Islami Chhatra Shibir, misused the name of Islam for violent purposes, especially during the Liberation War of 1971.
It's a strong and genuine demand because Jamaat-e-Islami or Islami Chhatra Shibir, these are not Islamic organizations. They have used the name Islam for the purpose of brutality. In 1971, during our liberation war, we have seen them killing persons, raping women, and whatnot. So, in the garb of Islam, they have no Islamic ideology. They have created a terror in this country. So that's why I strongly feel that this organization should not exist in a free country, in a democratic country.
The Jamaat-e-Islami, an extremely well-organized cadre-based party, was formed on the foundation of the Sharia philosophy, as intended by Maulana Maududi, the creator of the Jamaat movement in South Asia before the partition of India and Pakistan. The two military regimes of Zia-ul-Rahman and Hussein Muhammad Ershad, which succeeded Mujibur-Rahman, formed an Islamic image of Bangladesh and also methodically promoted Islam in Bangladesh society. The idea of secularism was replaced with one of absolute trust in Allah. Also, a government-managed Islamic university was established, making Islamic studies a compulsory topic for Muslim students in schools. Numerous mosques and madarsas, which were funded by Middle Eastern nations, were established. It wasn't long before all this percolated into politics. Islam was declared the state religion in 1987.
Jamaat-e-Islami cooperated with the Pakistan military to suppress the freedom fighters in Bangladesh. It opposed the independence of Bangladesh. But once Bangladesh got independence, Jamaat-e-Islami was there to do politics with the help of the military generals. This party has always been supported by the establishment, by the military, and it is the people who have come in the open to oppose the politics of Jamaat-e-Islami.
Meanwhile, in neighboring India, secularism survived. But in Pakistan, General Zia-ul-Haq, who took over the country on July 5, 1977, decided to commit his country to a system of Islam known as Nizam-e-Mustafa. Bangladeshi military regimes later entered into an agreement with the Jamaat-e-Islami, and the radicalization of society was attempted. In 1980s, the Jamaat joined the multi-party alliance for the reinstatement of democracy. Later, it allied with the late Zia-ul-Rahman's Bangladesh Nationalist Party, whose wife Khalida Zia is the leader of the opposition currently. The Jamaat-e-Islami has organized violent protests to destabilize the current democratically elected government of the Awami League, like at this rally in 2001 that killed over 20 people. It's also often been linked to several larger terrorist organizations such as the Taliban, the Harkat-ul-Jihad-e-Islami, Jamaat-ul-Mujahideen and Al-Qaeda. The Jamaat's jihad plan has been foiled time and time again by the Awami League government that is determined not to allow Bangladesh to go the Pakistan or the Afghanistan way. After coming to power in 2008, the Awami League government set about fulfilling its promise to the people, setting up of the International Crimes Tribunal, ICT, and bring to justice the 1971 war criminals. Prominent Jamaat leaders were charged and convicted. Livid with the sentences, the Jamaat retorted by trying to overthrow the government with the support of the army rebels in 2012, but failed. Since then, the Jamaat have launched a series of violent protests and demonstrations in a bid to coerce and put pressure on the Hasina government to stop the war trials. In its latest report, the US-based Human Rights Watch claims that in the violence incited by the Jamaat in the outcome of the war crimes trials, nearly 150 people have lost their lives. The War Crimes Tribunal termed the Jamaat a criminal organization for its anti-national role during the Liberation War of 1971. 10 of the 11 sentenced by the tribunal belong to the Jamaat-e-Islami. It includes prominent Jamaat leaders like Ghulam Azam, Dilawar Hussain Saidi, Abdul Qadir Mullah, and many others. Many have been sentenced to death.
After the much upsurge in Shahabag on 5th February 2013, they have been totally aware of their political rights. And after the Jamaat violence, after the verdict of Dilawar Hussain Saidi, the youth of Bangladesh have been able to come to know that how Jamaat-Islami, Jamaat-Shibir and Hifazat-Islam can be violent over the whole country. And just after their violence, the normal youth of Bangladesh have created a large number of officers at Shahabag. And after their movement of Shahabag, the conscious, the spirit and the stamina, the essence of the movement has spread out all over Bangladesh, and not only in Bangladesh but also in different territories in the world where the Bangla speaking people live in.
To make matters worse for the Jamaat, in a landmark ruling, a high court has declared Jamaat-e-Islami to be illegal under the constitution of Bangladesh. The court verdict came in response to a writ petition filed by a small religious organization, the Tariqat Federation, which claimed the Jamaat should be disqualified as the political party because its charter, which acknowledges the unconditional power of God, violates the constitution. The verdict came as a massive jolt to the Jamaat and its ally, the BNP. In protest, the Jamaat called for strikes and violent protests. Senior journalist and media advisor to Prime Minister Sheikh Hasina, Iqbal Sohban Chaudhary, said that banning of the Jamaat was important as the manifesto of the party was not in accordance with the constitution of the country.
In the recent verdicts against Jamaat-e-Islami, when the war criminals were tried in the tribunal declared Jamaat-e-Islami as a party of criminals and a fundamentalist party, and those who are involved in anarchy in the name of religion. So there had been a writ against Jamaat-e-Islami in the High Court. High Court also had given very recently a verdict to ban the Jamaat-e-Islami because their manifesto, party manifesto, doesn't go in conformity with the constitution of the country. So there is a popular demand that Jamaat-e-Islami should be banned.
Meanwhile, the BNP viewed the ban on the Jamaat-e-Islami as an attempt to weaken democratic tenets. Senior BNP leader Ahmed Azam Khan said, "Bangladesh is sensible and liberal democracy, and we should be allowed to practice democracy in a tolerant atmosphere." But Chaudhary said that the decision was in accordance to law and that it was the Election Commission and not the Awami League government which banned the Jamaat, and it was the EC's prerogative to decide on the party's registration.
It is the Election Commission which will decide whether they will allow Jamaat-e-Islami and keep the registration open. And there had been a, according to the constitution, the Jamaat-e-Islami was banned. But there is no instance till today whether any court had withdrawn the ban or restriction on Jamaat-e-Islami. Neither the Jamaat-e-Islami went to the court challenging the ban of their party. But as of today, when a new verdict has come from the High Court, they have gone to the higher court, that is the Supreme Court. And after the Supreme Court's verdict, the Election Commission will decide whether they will keep the registration to continue, or they will declare the party as banned as per the verdict of the Supreme Court.
A question which remains is, what will be the future of the Jamaat-e-Islami if the Supreme Court also upholds the ban on the outfit? In Pakistan, when the communists were banned, they worked with sympathetic allied partners through the National Awami Party. In Turkey, the Islamist-led Virtue Party, after being banned in 2001, along with many other factions, launched the AKP, the Justice and Development Party, this time projecting a sort of moderate image. The AKP won an absolute majority in the 2002 elections and has become the ruling party in Turkey. Though it's almost impossible for the Jamaat to shed its hardline image like the AKP and adopt a more inclusive image, just a mere change of name can work for the Islamist party, as it can carry out its earlier activities under a different banner. The Awami League, in contrast, offers a government that promotes pluralistic Bengali culture, very typical to Bangladesh. Exiled Bangladeshi writer Taslima Nasreen, who has been at the receiving end of the Jamaat's ire, said, "Allowing Jamaat to engage in political activism is an insult to the principles on which Bangladesh was founded." That's all we have for you in this episode. Thank you for watching Bangladesh Today.